Thank you, Kat. Thank you, team. And a very good morning to you. My name is Peter Scott. I serve here as the senior pastor, and it's great to be with you as we start a new topic, a new sermon series. It's called Big Topics. I think we've got a picture of an elephant there, so we're talking about some big things. But what are big topics? We thought it would be good to talk about some things that are current, complex, and impactful. Current, complex, and impactful. That's how we're kind of defining these big topics. They're things that are all around us and that we tend to talk about, but maybe we haven't talked about them in church quite as much. Things like climate and the environment, our first peoples, artificial intelligence. Some of these topics, they're current, they're complex, and they're impactful for us as individuals and for society around us. And we want to approach this whole series with this premise, that God's interested in these topics and that he has wisdom for them. So that's the sort of opening of this whole series. God is interested in these big topics and he has wisdom for us on them, wisdom on his view and wisdom on how to engage in these topics. Now, we've got 6 weeks in this series, and we're going to tackle 6 different topics. And because they're big topics, you might imagine that we actually can't delve into each of them to anywhere near the depth that each of us might like. And so what we're going to be trying to do is actually give some framing thoughts about these topics, an invitation to carry on investigating, because they're so big. We could spend entire series or months on these things and not get to the bottom. But our intention is to open up these topics in a way that gives us some framing thoughts and helps us as Christ followers engage in these big topics. So what should we tackle first? Come on. Let's talk about sex, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all of the things, talk about things that may be. Let's talk about sex. Let's talk about sex. Let's talk about Oh, we don't need to repeat it. That's a great song. Now, those of you who are over about 35 or 40 would just love that salt and pepper. Let's talk about sex. Sex. So, I know that some of you are already embarrassed. I know that some of you are already excited. I know that some of you are so uncomfortable that if I said, are you excited or embarrassed, you would not be able to lift your hand. And so let me start this topic with a couple of sort of preemptory opening thoughts, and that's this. First of all, however you're feeling as we embark on this journey of talking about sex, oh my goodness, in public, let alone in church, however you're feeling, there are others here who are feeling just the same way. Equally, this is a topic that is deeply personal and intimate, and so your journey is quite unique. So hold both those things. Sarah's already mentioned to us, we've talked about this and we wanted to calibrate it as a PG-13 type conversation. Now, the reason for that is because we do have our youth. We've got our young people in here. We wanted this to be a conversation that was for our normal church service. And so Sarah's talked about if you do have younger kids, great to have them across and carry kids. But I'd also say this. This is a conversation, and as we talk about it, that is a healthy one to be having at the right level with your children. So if you've got children here or you're online and you have children who are 12, 13, that's great. Just be able to talk with them. If you've got older teenagers, be great if you can have a conversation with them too. But just really important to say, we think this is about a PG-13. And finally, by way of preamble, there might be something for you in this conversation that triggers a deep emotion. We just want to invite you to be aware of that. There might be something that comes up that triggers something in you. Just be aware of that. Feel free, if you need to step out, no problem at all. If you need to talk to someone, we've got people here. We've got our pastors, our pastoral and discipleship elders, your friends here as Christ followers to talk with. And of course, if it's a really deep thing, and we'll talk about this a little bit as well, there's lots of professional help. So just be aware if there's something here that triggers for you. Right, where to start? Well, big topics require big picture thinking. And so I want to start with God and his intention in creating us. In Genesis 1, we read that God created mankind in his own image. And where I'm going with this, I want to paint this idea that God created us for intimate relationship. God's designed us for intimate relationship. We see that right in chapter 1, where God created people in his own image. Now, bear in mind that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God lives eternally in intimate relationship. Now, we won't go into the deep Trinitarian thinking about this, but even as we're created in his image, he lives as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In chapter 3 of Genesis, we see God and Adam and Eve in the garden, chatting. They are in this relationship that seems to be a beautiful one and free and carefree until the fall. And then after the fall and Adam and Eve come out of the garden, God shows in the rest of what we read in the Bible, this desire to get his people back, this desire for relationship with his people. That leads up to Jesus even coming, and God is so desirous of this relationship that he came in the form of a person. He came, we celebrate at Christmas, God as fully human. Jesus seeking intimate relationship with us so much that he was prepared to become a human being. But it doesn't stop there, actually. It's something special for us today. Because when Jesus died and rose again, he sent the Holy Spirit. And Romans 8:11 tells us that in the covenant of faith through Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells inside us. It doesn't get much more intimate than that. So right up front, I want to suggest to you that God has designed us and he wants an intimate relationship with us. His design and desire is for intimate covenant relationship with him. Now, if then we're creatures designed for intimate relationships, it makes sense that a loving creator would design for us and guide us toward a way of living that develops intimate relationship. So for those of you who are impatient, let's get on to sex. Now, I haven't said that word for a few minutes, so we'll come back to, yeah, but what about sex? Well, we take this premise of what God's designed us for, and then we say, well, yeah, but what does the Bible say about sex? And here's where I wanted to come with a verse, a text, a passage that we can kind of center our thinking on. And what better than to choose a passage that both Jesus and the Apostle Paul, as he's writing to the churches, refer to multiple times. The passage is Genesis 2, verse 24. If you've got a Bible or on your phone, I'd really encourage you to have that out. Whenever we open our Bible, I really encourage us to just be familiar with it. So grab that out. I'm going to have it up on the screen as well. But this is our central text for today. And by the way, when I often practice giving my sermons, and I had a moment where I was practicing, I must have been a bit tired, and I spoke out the words, this is our central sex, but that's not. This is a central text for this morning, Genesis 2, 24. It happens to be part of the creation account, and so it's also intrinsically linked to God's design for life. Let's unpack it. The first thing we note is that the verse refers to a man who leaves his mother and father. Man who leaves his mother and father. Sex is for adults. More than that, sex is in a context where people are able to step into an ability to have responsibility for somebody else, to take care of somebody else. If we read a little bit further into this passage and understand the context of this passage is in a Hebrew culture. And what's fascinating in Hebrew culture is actually that, in some ways, the man didn't leave mum and dad. In other words, typically, it was the woman that came to live with that family. And the man would actually stay in same proximity, in the same sort of estate or region as mum and dad. So what does it mean to leave mother and father? Well, actually, what it means is to change my priority of relationship. So growing up as a young man, this Hebrew young man would have had his focus on how do I serve? My primary responsibility is to serve mum and dad and this family. And this verse is saying, but that at a certain point, that primary responsibility shifts to the woman. Now, for the woman, of course, it's more than that, because not only is she shifting her responsibility as she leaves mother and father, but also geographically, it's sort of more obvious for her. She is leaving where she was and she is shifting responsibility and accountability to this new relationship. And so this is the context in which sex occurs, as referred to in God's design and by Jesus and Paul. It's a context where responsibility is being taken and priority of relationship is being made. And the verse goes on to describe that priority as, and this is the next part, being united to his wife. United to his wife. Now, a commentator I read used a beautiful expression here. He said that explains, or it contains the idea of passion and permanence. Passion being all the beautiful and good and exciting parts of sexual union, and permanence being this is an ongoing thing. In fact, others would say this refers to the idea of covenant. That being united to his wife was that man and woman make a covenant with each other. Now, what is a covenant? Well, this is something that we see God make with people throughout the Bible. He's made it with us. And it's the idea of not being a contract where there are exit clauses, but something permanent and deep, and where the covenanter makes sacrifice for the person with or people with whom the covenant is made, and that they benefit. And it's in that sense of covenant, permanent and passionate relationship where intimacy flourishes and grows, and that's where the magic happens. The one flesh. That's where the sex happens. That's where, in God's design, we come to this idea of they were united and they become one flesh. A reference to the act of sexual intercourse and being together. This beautiful design that God has for our bodies. It's more than that, this one flesh idea, though. It also speaks of the spiritual union of two people. Now, Paul, in 1 Corinthians 6:18, he refers to this and says that actually sexual intercourse is uniquely expressive of our whole being. And he goes on to talk about the analogy with Christ and ourselves and the analogy with something we've already talked about, which is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. One flesh contains the idea of a spiritual union as well. It speaks also of an emotional closeness and to the idea of if that couple, that man and woman, are blessed with children. That's a fairly clear one flesh. The two have joined and produced one, a child. And so here we see in Genesis 2:24, God's view of and design for sex. It occurs in this context of a prioritized, intimate, covenant relationship. It occurs between people committed to looking after one another. And it's a physical, spiritual, an emotional joining together of two people that fosters a deep intimacy. Now, I want to add something here and say that, importantly, we're not defined by sex. So sex is a part of our being, and it occurs in this particular context. There's no place in God's word that suggests that sex defines who we are as humans. And in fact, if we look at the lives of both Paul and Jesus, we would read those as being not sexually active, but fully human and fully flourishing and fully on the mission that God has for them and in deep, intimate relationship with God. So sex doesn't define who we are. But this is God's view of and design for sex out of Genesis 2:24. I don't know if you've seen the TV show, it's called Bull. One of the things that Bull has, he has this ability to, he's a clinical psychologist, and he's able to get up a screen, and on the screen, he can see whether the jurors in the court cases that he's running are green or red. Are they with him or are they against him? And I thought, gee, that'd be handy to have at this point in the sermon. I've presented God's design for sex and just see, reds, greens, where is everybody? People changing. Because as you hear that idea, I've just put forward a suggestion for what God's design for sex in our lives is. I wonder if there's something for you going, but I see the world a bit differently. Or perhaps, yeah, but you know, my life hasn't kind of worked out that way. I don't really live in a perfect world. I haven't lived a perfect life. Yeah, but I don't want to address those two big areas. I want to talk about some, I hear that idea, but I see it differently. Or I hear that idea and you know what, that's in my life, that's not quite how it's panned out. So let's talk about those two things. Yeah, I like that idea from Genesis 2:24, but no, I actually see it differently. It's not practical today. Or, Peter, I actually enjoy what I'm doing and it's consensual. I don't see the problem. I enjoy what I'm doing and no one else knows and it's not actually hurting anybody. Everyone's doing it and most of them seem fine. Or perhaps your objection here is, sex isn't a big deal. It's just not a big deal. Maybe you've got a whole bunch of other objections. I can't list all of the potential objections or different world view that you might have. But what I want to say to you is those are really important things to recognize. So if as I was talking through that idea of this is God's view of sex, and you thought, not sure I see it that way, I encourage you to hold on to that as we go through and talk. I think it's great because actually in Perth in 2022, each one of the objections that I've listed at least, I think has an absolutely legitimate basis in our culture. Let me just say that again. I think each of those objections to God's design has a legitimate basis in our culture. Well, what do you mean by that, Peter? Well, let me just explain what I mean. I think that our view on sex is heavily shaped by our worldview. What is life about? How does it work? And I want to give you two alternate worldviews to the one that I've just presented, that's out of Genesis 2:24, and see whether they sort of, you connect to those and you think, oh, actually, yeah, I think I'm shaped a little bit by these. Here's number one. We live in a culture whose focus and narrative is that actually my identity is determined by me. My identity is determined by me. So my greatest freedom and fullness in life will come from being more me. And true to me. And in turn, if actually there's no external reference point like God, then allowing my desire free rein, unless of course they impinge on someone else's desire, I recognize I'm part of society, but actually I should be allowed to let myself do what I want to do, then ultimately we get to the point where experience is the paramount thing. And that actually what I choose to do, including and perhaps especially with respect to sex, is really underpinned fundamentally by what works best for me. And that's who I am. That's a worldview that I think is pretty common today. Let me present you with one other worldview as we're talking about these ideas of what shapes our views, particularly around sexuality. And actually, before I move on to that worldview I just expressed, it's not new. Paul, when he's writing to all his letters, he's actually writing into a culture which was heavily influenced by Hellenism, by Greek and Roman thinking. It was a culture with very liberal views and practices of sex. And so Paul refers a lot in his letters to sex and sexuality. So this idea of the culture of we live in Perth in 2022, it's not new. But let me give you a second example. I've decided to name this idea of a worldview, and I've called it this. It's the hyper-Christian, whatever you do, don't talk about sex because it's functional and or dirty. Whatever you do, don't talk about sex. We're Christians. Now, in this view, you've got to keep yourself completely pure from any sexual thought or action until you get married. Now, when you get married, one of two things is going to happen. Either you will have sex, but it's purely for procreation. It's purely for making children that will come to know Jesus. Or when you get married, oh, let me tell you, God designed sex. And immediately on marriage, you will find that your spouse and your desires sync up perfectly in timing and frequency. And, oh, hallelujah, forever and ever, amen, sex will be amazing. I think I heard a few laughs about that one. I'm painting a picture here of a sort of rigid worldview that's fairly narrow. And the third point that I actually had before marriage, during marriage, is that if you fail at either of those things, you're probably bad. You need to repent and pray harder, and certainly you need to suffer in silence. That is a worldview that I think some people may have experienced. So there's one. We talked about another, which is my identity, and I want to contrast them with the Genesis 2:24 worldview. A little bit of exaggeration, a little bit of humour in that last one, but what I want to suggest is that's not healthy nor biblical. And I want to invite you in this space of worldview to ask the question, what is shaping my worldview on sex? So if we talk through Genesis 2:24 and you said, I see it a little differently, I just want to invite you to ask the question, what is shaping your view? What worldview is bringing into the picture for you that is shaping your view on sex? And how does your faith in Jesus play into your views on sex? I'm not going to answer those. I just think they're really important questions to answer this morning, or to ask this morning. Let me move on to our second category of yeah, buts. I like that God idea, but my life, I've been really deeply hurt. Or perhaps I've deeply hurt someone. I like God's idea of sex, but frankly, my partner doesn't see it the Genesis 2:24 way. I'm not married, but my partner and I are having sex, and I think that's okay. I've tried the God way, and I failed. Or how about this one? I really like that God design idea, but I watch pornography sometimes and not sure how to stop. In fact, I'm kind of not sure I want to. There are lots of examples here in this space of our imperfect world. And right up front, I want to say this, that I believe God looks at each of us with a deep fondness and compassion in our brokenness, in all areas of life. So if this is you and you've come this morning and we're talking about this topic of sex and you think, oh yeah, I'm supposed to be excited, but actually, I'm not. God loves you. God loves us. And I want you to take note of the fact that Genesis 2:24 is before the fall. So in other words, I was talking to somebody about this. This is in kind of page 3 of the Bible for like several thousand pages. This is God's initial design, his ideal, his hope. But just like everything else in humanity, we don't live in a perfect world. And soon after God said, this is sort of the ideal, Adam and Eve mess up and they ship out of the garden. And then we read through the Old Testament and we see a messy, messy sexual history of the people of God. The heroes are messy when it comes to sex. In fact, they mess up, but God loves them. He uses them, and he even says of one of them, this is a person after my own heart, despite the messing up part around the perfect ideal of sex. And finally, in this space, I want to invite you to read, and we're not going to read it now, but if you're feeling broken in the area of sexuality, I just invite you to read again John chapter 8, verses 1 to 11. Because what we see there is that Jesus encounters a person who is broken, who has not perhaps been living or hasn't had the experience that I'm a Genesis 2:24 person. And have a look at how Jesus loves that person. I want to share two principles in this space. Principle one is that God redeems. In our lives, we often think about, or maybe it's just me, but I often think about God's redemption as this sort of broad thing for all of my life. I rarely apply that to my sex and my sexuality. But God redeems that space too. Jesus said in John 10:10, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. And I believe that refers to our sex and our sexuality as well. God is a God of redemption. It's written through the entire Bible. Now, as we talk about redemption, I do want to raise one topic. It's the P word. I want to just briefly talk about pornography. I want to make this statement. Watching pornography reduces intimacy. Now, the attractiveness of porn is that it's self-gratification. But what it does is that it moves the watcher away from the process of building intimacy. A difficult, challenging, time-consuming process, porn takes you away from that process of building intimacy, whether you're married or single. It's really best likened to a highly addictive drug. It gives short-term hits, and it is addictive. Now, Paul spoke, perhaps not directly about pornography, but about where pornography sort of heads when he said this in Ephesians. He says, having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Pornography never satisfies. And I found it fascinating. 2,000 years later, Time magazine, in April 2016, did an issue on porn. So if you're familiar with Time magazine, they sort of usually have a headline issue, and the cover of this one just says, porn. And the headline article in it, they do a long interview with a person that I don't think is a Christian, but he's somebody who's actually inviting or has started a business to help people off pornography. He says, I want to help people get off their addiction to porn. And there was this quote in this article that I thought was really insightful. Let me share it with you. This person running this business says, all super stimulating things like internet porn, junk food and drugs. Let's just pause there. How do you like that combination? Internet porn, junk food and drugs can be fun and pleasurable temporarily. However, they also have the potential to desensitize you to normal, natural things. And here's the bit that I've highlighted in my notes. He says, they can ultimately rob you of the one thing you thought they would give you, the ability to experience pleasure. The reason to call out porn this morning is because it is ubiquitous and it's highly addictive. But I want to encourage you that we're designed for more. We're designed for intimacy and relationship. And that this morning and every day that God's redemption is available and he meets us right where we're at with compassion and love. God's idea of redemption applies to all areas of our lives. And that brings me to principle two in this space, and this will lead us to the end this morning. Principle two, we've talked about God redeeming. God also transforms. God is in the business of transforming. We're told by Paul to put off our old self and put on our new. We all fall short of the mark. We call that sin. We fall short of the mark, God's perfect ideal and design in many areas of our lives. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, when we step into that belief in Jesus and the covenant with him, we are in the process of being transformed by the Holy Spirit in us. And so I want to put that call to you using two words in juxtaposition that you might not have heard before. I want to suggest to you the idea of sexual discipleship. Sexual discipleship. Now, let me unpack what that means, because I've shared this with a couple of people and they was like, well, hang on, you're really going to have to talk me through that one. What am I suggesting here? Well, first of all, we are a place who is in the process of being and making disciples. That's our mission statement, to be and make disciples. And that's people who are following the words, works and ways of Jesus to influence how we live, our worldview and our behaviours. And my question for us, which we sort of started with that idea of worldview, is how are you being, or how have you been discipled? What has shaped the way you think? What has shaped the way you behave when it comes to sexuality? Where do you get your information? How do you understand it? Who do you talk to about this? And the headline invitation this morning is this: to pursue intentional discipleship in the area of sex. How's that for an invitation at church? Pursue intentional discipleship on sex, and I'm going to give you six just thoughts on how you might do that. And actually, all of those thoughts are very similar to how we pursue discipleship in every aspect of our life. So the first area, and this is, we will lead this into prayer and closing. The first area I want to suggest is repentance and recommitment. We do that in all areas of our lives. There is a moment and a choice for us to say, Lord, actually, maybe I haven't been hitting the mark. Maybe I haven't been doing this right. I just want to bring it before you. Or perhaps you're thinking, actually, I'm pretty happy. There's still a space to just say, thank you, Lord. Let me recommit this area to you. Number two is to pray about our next steps. We come out of a 25-minute sermon and there might be some things that are registering in us. I believe the Holy Spirit has this incredible ability to use one set of words and speak to every person in this room about what they need to hear, about what you need to hear, about what I've needed to hear. So our next step is we need to pray about what that next step is. And here I want to emphasize, for those of you for whom there is something deep and painful, that healing is available. And that it may be that this is a prompt and a call for you to step into a process of healing. We are going to have our pastoral and discipleship elders later on able to pray with you. You may have a close friend you can pray with. It may be that you need to go to somebody professional in this space. But just as we spent all of last term, or at least 7 weeks, talking about soul care, talking about the practices of paying attention to developing and the health of our soul, same with this area of our life in sexuality. Let's pray about whether we need healing. Pray about what the next steps are. Point number three, find the right person or people to walk the discipleship journey with. Now, for some of us, this is not something we talk about. A small group is far too big a group. So let me give you some suggestions what I mean by this. It's sensitive and intimate, but good to be able to talk to somebody as we journey. If you are single or a teen, you might want to find a trusted advisor, a mentor, a really close friend to be able to talk this topic through with. Somebody with the same worldview. So if you want to be having a worldview that begins with God, then find a person who holds that same worldview. For marrieds, your spouse, of course. Maybe this is an area that needs to open up in conversation. For some, maybe that's too hard. Maybe there is a need to find a trusted friend or even a counsellor to start the journey. Families, discuss it as age appropriate with your kids. So I'm going to share a couple of resources with you in a minute. Number four, read and pray about the biblical worldview. So as we think about how we get discipled, start in the scripture. Meditate on Genesis 2:24. Find other passages in scripture that are helpful and ask God to speak to you through his word. Number five, get hold of some resources. Some years ago, I went to a seminar by a lady called Dr. Patricia Wirra-Coon. Some of you may have heard of her. And she's written a bunch of books. I've got three of them here. Happy for you to come and have a look later on. The first one's called Growing Up, and it's targeted actually at 10 to 14-year-olds. And the idea that a parent, perhaps having had a look at this first, can share this with a 10 to 14-year-old and say, this is a really important topic. Let's look at this. Have a read of this. This is a healthy way of beginning. For our teens, so this one's called Teen Sex by the Book. The book being the Bible, of course. 15 plus. That goes into some deeper topics that highly likely our teens are already talking about in lots of other areas. So let's talk as families. And finally, this one called The Best Sex for Life. It covers all sorts of things. We haven't had time to go into any of the specific areas today. That covers lots of stuff. One of the things that I thought was fabulous was it talks about sex for the 75 plus group. So I'm almost expecting I know what the next topic for our seniors is as we go forward. But just really good to get good resources. I've actually got another one here that I don't know where to get it. We actually found it in another country, and that's for 8 to 11-year-olds. There are resources out there. See what you can find that's healthy. And finally, Perhaps start to identify if there are areas in your life that you need to reduce the influence of those areas. Perhaps they're showing you a worldview that actually is not the one you want to be following. And so as disciples, we say, actually, I want to get that input. I don't need that input. I'm going to close in prayer now, having given those thoughts about how we might pursue intentional discipleship in this beautiful, complex, current, impactful topic of sex. And as I pray, I'm going to pray a couple of things, and I'm going to give us a moment for reflection. First, I'm going to just pray for any of us who would like to repent. I'm going to pray for any of us who want to recommit our lives in this area. I'm going to pray a prayer of thanks and great joy for this area. And at a certain point, I'm just going to invite you. This is that awkward moment. I'm going to invite you to respond. I'm going to give you an opportunity while we're praying, eyes are closed, heads bowed, just to stand. And why am I going to do that? So this is not a standing of embarrassment. I want to invite you to stand if this is an area where you say, actually, I want to live this as best I can from the point at which I am now, which for all of us is broken. I want to move forward with God in this space. So I'll invite you to do that. Don't feel any pressure to do that. The reason we give this sort of invitation is because actually the physical act of doing something different, maybe it's a bit scary because there are actually other people here, but it's actually an opportunity for me before God to say, Lord, there's something shifting. Thank you. So would you join with me in prayer as we bring this before our Heavenly Father? And Lord, we want to start simply with a moment of reflection to allow us to confess, to repent, anything that you've prompted us to in these moments. And next, just a few moments, Lord, we spend before you uttering words of thanks and joy and excitement for the gift of sex. For this amazing and beautiful thing that is just incredible. We thank you. And now I want to invite anyone who'd like to commit or recommit to seeking God's direction and discipleship for sex in your life to stand. Just quietly where you are, perhaps with your hands open, as a sign of saying, Lord, I just submit myself to you in this area. I thank you. I recommit. Perhaps I repent and I want to change, but Lord, let me follow you. So I invite you now, if that's something that you want to do, to stand with your hands open. Gracious and loving Father, I know I've been standing all the time, Lord, but I stand before you with my hands open. Today we've talked about the deeply intimate experience of sex. We want to thank you for the incredible gift that it is. I want to pray for your wisdom and conviction that we might understand your design, your purposes for this incredible gift. And that we might enjoy it in our lives in the freedom and the context for which you made it. Father, we also bring our past, our present, our hurts, our places that need healing, our joys and our disappointments to you. We place it before you as part of who we are this day. And we thank you that you want to redeem all aspects of our lives. And that, Lord Jesus, that is why you came, to give us life and life to the full. Thank you that it is never too late with you, our good and gracious Father. And so we pray now for each of us and collectively that you would guide us, that we might realign the things that we do in the way we think about and the way we treat sex to be in line with your design. Please lead us, disciple us in this area as in all others. This we pray in your precious name, Lord Jesus. Amen.